Hey guys, welcome to the jungle. We got fun and games. What, you didn't like that one?
It was good. Ben, I gotta tell you about this one time I was at Universal and I was on the tram ride and then they were doing a Nope, like, tour. So we went through the, was it Jumper's Claims? The little amusement park. And I look off to the side and then there's fucking Slash, like, getting a private tour of this place.
By himself?
No, I guess with some family or friends or something, but yeah, that was Groupies. Interesting. And then on my way out, we were walking to the parking lot, and right by the Buca de Beppo, there was a fuck. There he comes out again, of a, like a big ass car. I was destined to meet him, but he didn't have his hat.
Did he have his hair tied back?
No, it was down, and the shades on. It was nighttime though.
He looked like Slash.
Yep. It was Slash.
You know, I guess, yeah, he was Slash and he looked like Slash. I guess if you're that kind of a rock star, I mean, maybe you deserve special treatment, maybe you don't, I don't know. They work hard enough, don't they? Whether you like their music or not.
I think so.
Yeah, well, private tour, what the hell?
Probably pay for it.
Probably afford it.
Yeah.
That kind of reminded me of something that happened to me. Yeah. That reminded me of something that happened to me when I was a kid at, like, Disneyland. You know that Thunder Mountain ride? It's, like, the one that's almost a roller coaster?
Yeah.
I've never been.
I think... Oh, no? Oh, yeah. Canadian. I think... I must have been about 8 or 9 or something, and we're on that ride... And there's a guy a few carts, like maybe like 5 carts ahead of me, and I see him on the ride, and he's bald, and I'm looking at his head, I'm like he's got like a little patch of hair on top, and I'm like, this guy's head looks fucking weird, and I'm like, okay, whatever, and I get off the ride, and he like walks by, and he's like a burn victim, so he has this like fucking deformed face, and I remember it like, I don't know, it totally traumatized me the rest of the day. I couldn't stop thinking about this, like, burn victim.
It was burned in the it was burned in your head.
Yes, his burned face was burned into my mind. I remember it scared me.
Well, on a lighter note, I have another Universal one. I was on the horror nights, and you had to
take horror nights?
The horror nights, yeah.
Right.
And we went down to one of the rides, I mean one of the mazes, and they took us on a tram, and then right in front of us, you know the rapper, The Game?
Yeah.
He like sits right in front of us, and I didn't realize at the time, but I saw on the back of his shirt, it was like a jersey, and it said Game. I was like, oh, why, like, he ends up wearing his own merch and shit, like, I don't know.
That's cool. That's funny.
But yeah, I was pretty close to him. Tall guy.
That also reminded me of something else. I think I've told you this one before, Paul. Fred, you know who Ross Sewage is? From Ghoul and Exhumed?
Like, is that the person's name?
His name is Ross Sewage. Okay.
Oh, Ross. I thought you said Ross. I get it now.
Yeah, Ross Sewage.
I know the bands. I have some of their albums, but I don't know the members very well, except for Matt Harvey.
Damn.
I went to a show with, I think it was, when was this, man? Maybe 2017 or 2016 or something. And it was Repulsion and Ghoul. And I think Municipal Waste was headlining, and I left early because I was tired. And I went, like, right next door, there's a pizza place. And I like fish on my pizza. I like anchovies on my pizza. I know everybody's like disgusted by that.
Well, I gotta try that.
Yeah, but I got like a small like a slice of pizza or whatever with fish on it. And I was sitting down, and Ross and I guess it was his girlfriend or something, they sat right across from me, and I was like, hey, how's it going, man? And they give me my pizza with the fish on it, and he just looks at me, and he just like kind of shakes his head really lightly. I'm like, okay, well, I'm gonna get this to go. I don't feel like sitting here anymore. This like vegan, he's like a vegan. He looked very like he disapproved of my fish pizza or something, or maybe he was just disgusted that it stunk.
Yeah, maybe. I don't think I've been around when that's been made.
Oh, the fish pizza.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember my old coworker. He like this old Mexican guy, because he used to eat that, and I had never eaten it. And I know like everybody hates it. I was like,
Yeah.
"How is that?" He goes, "Oh, he goes delicious." So I
He's
gave him a
right.
try. And yeah, it's been it's. I think that was the last time that I had a fish on a pizza was that show.
That also traumatized
No, that didn't
you?
traumatize me. I thought it was just like slightly funny.
I mean, hearing about it kind of traumatizes me.
But Fred, you got any of your any stories like that? Any run-ins with people?
Run-ins with burn victims or metal celebrities or Slash?
I mean, not random ones. Mostly ones I would expect from just being at a show. I have a bullet belt from. You guys know Tomb Mold?
Yes.
Yeah. They wear
The.
glasses.
Yes, they do. The
They
the drummer
can't see.
used to be in a band called Crucifix Sodomy, and on one of their shows, I'm just sitting at a table in the bar, and he just basically walks up to the table and just slams down the bullet belt and says, "I'm sick of this thing. My hair keeps getting caught in it." And I just told him, "I'll buy it off of you," and that's how I got the bullet belt.
You wear it around town?
Always.
That's
Wear it to
cool.
work.
There was guys that wore bullet belts to school, I remember. Like freshmen walking around in bullet belts.
How'd they get that past security?
Yeah, seriously. How
that
do they
was
let that
Julian, I
fly?
think. Well, they put it on their belt. They're not wearing it around their shoulder. They're wearing it
They're
as a
like,
belt accessory.
as long as you're not sagging, you're good.
Yeah, well, if you have your t-shirt down, nobody's even gonna know it's there.
It's like, well, I could take it off, but then my pants will fall. So, I mean, so your choice.
Yeah. Well, I don't even think they were using it as a belt. They were using it more as like a thrash accessory.
Yeah, I think I've worn it to a show like maybe once or twice. So it's not my thing. I still have.
Have you ever got painted? You ever got painted up for a show?
No.
You never, you're not wearing it right now? The bull belt?
No, absolutely not. I'm wearing shorts and a perturbator shirt, so.
Be a lot cooler if you did.
Yeah, we can wait.
Wow.
Now we're waiting. Go put it on, dude.
No, but I do have beer. I'm able to grab one of those.
Whoa, there you go.
Holy shnikes.
I know. I
Fred's
know.
gonna get turned. Oh, this is your second week of vacation.
It is, and I'm enjoying it. Well, today's a day off for us in Canada. I don't know about you guys, but so everyone's off today. Tomorrow, my
What's the
vacation
occasion?
is. I don't even know anymore.
Maple Day?
Maple Day.
You hear D?
No.
No, it's just a civic holiday. It's literally called civic holiday.
Civic holiday for like civil servants?
Just a day off, huh? It's like
Yeah,
Labor
pretty
Day,
much.
huh? Huh.
Yeah, no, it's just called civic holiday. There's nothing really special about it.
Canadians
You remember
are
how you were talking about Steve Hughes, I think, when we were talking to Nick?
Yeah, guy from Mortal
You
Sin.
remember he got kind of big, like maybe 5 years ago. He was
As a
doing
comedian?
jokes about, yeah, as a comedian. I
Yeah.
remember his stuff was like getting viral.
Yeah,
I
he
think
has
the
some really
joke,
good stuff.
yeah, some of it was pretty funny. I think the one that he was popular for was like people getting offended all the time. He said like,
Yep.
he goes, what if, he goes, when you get offended, and what? Nothing happens. It's not like you get offended and you wake up with leprosy.
Yep. That's a great a great bit.
There was another one I used to like a lot. He was talking about inviting his friends to his shows, and he's like talking as his friends. He goes, "Yeah, Steve, we're having a great time. We are going crazy here." I don't know. I like that line. We are going crazy here.
Yeah, like what's it called? Mitch Hedberg's metal jokes. Have you heard those?
No, I don't think I have. I like Mitch though. I do like him.
He was
Yeah, he
like,
was great.
I guess he has a few. He was like, "Oh, I was in a band for 7 years. It was a death metal band. People either loved us or they hated us, or they thought we were okay."
That's a good joke.
Then the other one was just a lot of death metal bands have intense names like rigor mortis, mortuary, or obituary. We weren't that intense, so we just went with injured.
I'm injured.
Yeah. That was it, pretty much.
There was one he did. I forget exactly how this goes, but he goes, I'm addicted to heroin. He goes, I used to be addicted to heroin. I used to like having sex with women who save people.
I used to like metal. I still do.
I used to be addicted
But I
to
used to.
drugs, but I still do them. But I also used to.
If carrots got you drunk, rabbits be fucked up.
Rabbits be fucked up.
Rice is the perfect food when you want a little bit or a lot of a little thing.
A thousand of something, yeah. No, one of my favorites is something like, I took the lid off of a yogurt and said, try again. I did not know there was a contest going, so I thought I opened it wrong.
Yeah, that guy's great.
Think I told Paul I think it's one of the first Louis Anderson stand-ups. That one's really good. The one from like 87.
I don't think I've watched that one yet.
Check that one out. It's pretty good. It's just a lot of like family humor, but it works.
Man, I got to a good episode on Frasier. Finally, like season six now, almost nearing
Okay.
seven,
You're ooh.
where Niles and Frasier have like a charity, and then they end up like bidding against each other and get like a dinner for both of them for like $8,000 with like three Nobel Prize winners.
Is that the one where they like have the IQ test or
Yeah.
something? Yeah, I think I remember that one.
Yeah, and then they're at the dinner, and then like I guess the night before, they were hanging out, and then they like left early for like some unassuming reasons, and then they come to find out they're like both researching to
Yeah, they
like
were like
have,
cramming.
yeah, and like Fraser had a bunch of coffee the night before, so his eyes were just like twitching, and then Niles had like a fucking like paper allergy or paper mite allergy, so like
Oh,
he had to take some pills, and then he was just like all flopped up on the table, like slurring his speech and shit. That was funny.
I saw an okay movie. Pretty more than okay, I guess. The movie Unlawful Entry with Kurt Russell and Ray Liotta. It's kind of like a cable guy stalker situation.
Okay.
90s movie. It, I'd say it's worth it. People. Like I was looking on like comments on YouTube, people seem to like that one a lot.
Seen that.
Yeah, me either.
The last Ray Liotta movie I saw was Cocaine Bear.
Oh, yeah, I saw
He
that.
died, didn't he? I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I
Is,
think
that
he
must
was
have been
a.
recently, right?
Yeah, it was last year.
Dude, I don't think I even heard about that. I didn't hear anybody fucking making a stink about it.
It's the way he wanted it.
Yeah, I guess so. I forgot to mention last episode, or it, I guess last episode ha isn't going to come out for a while, so makes it's better that I didn't. That we got a new release on the label coming out pretty soon. I'll say
Oh
the
yeah.
CDs will be here in a week or two. Band called Dungeon Crypt. I actually found that through one of the commenters. I think it was that dude Shannon. He's like, stop going through my record collection. So I went through his playlist and I found this band. But it's a one-man project from Czech Republic, and it's pretty cool stuff. It's like, what would you call that, Paul? It's like death doom, but really, really traditional metal influenced.
Yeah,
You even say it could be like Manowar sounding
yeah,
stuff,
I
kind
was
of.
saying like it was like Manowar, death metal, but also like slowed down doom. But the whole aesthetic is like prehistoric shit, so it definitely sounded like primitive, like just like the bare essentials of what you need for those genres, you know?
Yeah, and like I was telling you,
And
it's
those
kind of
vocals are
weird.
weird as
Yeah, the
fuck.
vocals are very weird. There's some chanting stuff on there, and that's cool.
Yeah.
But
Which
it's
is it a new release or something they've already put out?
it's something they put out just only digitally. It's going to be a compilation of their last his last full length and then the latest EP. So the full length was 2020, the EP was this year, 2023. So it's about a
Okay.
40-minute thing, like compilation thing.
Right on.
Yeah, but it's interesting. I was telling Paul, like, this guy, he has another one-man project. It's like black power metal called Cave Blind. It's pretty cool stuff too. I guess that guy, he's really into like the traditional heavy metal and also like the more flowery, newer type of power metal, kind of like Rhapsody or like Iron Savior, Spell Blast, stuff like that.
And he said Mortician too.
Yeah. But he said the only two death metal bands he really listens to at all are Mortician and Cancer. And so you
That's
get.
such a bizarre choice of two bands.
Yeah, it is. It is. And that I think that's why his music in Dungeon Crypt is so bizarre. Because it's
Yeah,
like a heavy
fair
metal
enough.
guy with like two bands like to take from. It really is interesting stuff.
Yeah.
It's really primitive though. But I liked it. That's he responded right away and he was ready to do it.
Yeah, it reminded me of Ortolan a little bit. The heavy metal aesthetics to it.
Votholon?
Ortolan. The guy that.
Othalon.
Yeah.
Oh.
Ortana, I mean.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it is Othalon.
That was a
Othana,
great
I think
album.
he. Yeah, it is. It's interesting. They're doing a bunch of shows right now. I think they just have. I think they just got some like HD live footage. If anybody wants to check them out.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I got to.
Yeah, and they got a drummer now. Before it was just the two guys and a drum machine on stage, but yeah, they got three members now. They got the pagan corpse paint.
Oh, goody.
That album reminded me so much of Countess, though, which is a good compliment. Countess
Yeah,
being one of my
it
favorite
is.
bands.
Any release in particular that reminded you of?
Mostly like their middle era where they really let the traditional heavy metal influence come through, like Spawn of Steel, Heiligwehr, those albums around there.
Yeah, because early on they really did have a like raw black metal sound to them, didn't they?
Yeah, like there was still a lot of traditional influence in there, but it wasn't as like they were still trying to go
Black
necro, for
metal.
lack of a better term, yeah.
Yeah.
And then they, after Shining Swords, they kind of just let that traditional metal influence just come ringing through clear as a bell.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the first few albums and also the demo. I think it's called Permafrost. And
That's before,
also.
what's his name? Orlok even joined.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
Yeah, well,
there's
I like that one too.
technically no original members in Countess left.
Oh shit, I didn't know that.
Yeah, they were formed by a few other guys, and then Orlok joined, I think, for the second demo, if I remember correctly. And eventually it became Orlok's project, so.
Wah
I mean,
wah.
there was only one demo without him, but still.
Yeah, the Fires of Destiny, one of their later albums. I really like that one a lot.
Yeah, that's a great album. The fires of destiny burn in the night.
Yeah, and Fly the Battle Flag. I think that was the one with the music video. They were just like in their practice space.
Oh, I don't know. Didn't see a music video.
Yeah, their singer looks just like a really normal dude. Like too normal.
Yeah, he does now. Like back then, obviously, it was just like long hair and corpse paint, but now he's just short hair and a beard.
It's like guy.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, what are we here for today, Dan?
What are we
here
for?
I don't know.
Just chilling.
It's just a Monday.
It's me stretching. Well, I guess we're going to talk about Codex Gigas from Sweden. And their 1990 demo, Myom. I guess this band really doesn't have... It's kind of unusual for Swedish bands. Swedish bands usually have all kinds of connections, huh? Like to, just like all kinds of shit. Yeah. Seems like this band doesn't have really any connections. They're connected to, well, they changed their name. That's really it.
They're connected to themselves.
They're connected to themselves, yeah.
Yeah, and funny thing, when I looked that up, all I can find was, like, brain surgeries on YouTube.
Oh, I looked it up, too. I tried to find it as well.
Yeah, I was like, I wonder what they'll sound like later, because I heard a bit of Livid. I didn't check out the last demo, but I feel like...
You can't find the last demo.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's the same one as when they changed their name.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I heard some of the Livid stuff. Yeah. I didn't really realize this when I listened to the... I don't even remember when I first listened to this or why it kind of... came into my mind. I knew about this, like I had it in my iPod years and years and years ago, and I found it again randomly on YouTube a few weeks back, and I thought it would be interesting to cover, but I didn't really think about it. I always thought it was cool, but it's kind of weird, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really weird.
Yeah, weird demo.
I gotta think, say
that second track is bizarre.
Yeah, it is bizarre.
I was going to say, they got a really good image, though. I love their logo and their band photo where it's like Xerox and fuck. It, like, I don't know, it's just like a lot of negative and negative white and black and shit.
Sick. I really like the cover of this demo.
Oh, you skull boy.
The demonic face.
Yeah. How exactly did they do that? Did they just like cut, it looked like they kind of cut an image out not correctly. And then pasted it on white.
It looks kind of like a primate skull with horns.
Yeah, but it's got it looks like it has kind of pincers on the other end too, like horns coming out the bottom.
Yeah.
I heard or I saw in a comment somebody said this is like the Swedish Goat Lord. Does that make any sense at all?
Not to me.
Yeah. Maybe in terms of how early they were.
It is pretty early to be this weird, I think.
I don't hear a ton of Goat Lord similarities myself.
Mm-mm.
I think I might hear some the faster riffs. I think those are kind of like Belial, Wisdom of Darkness sort of riffs.
Yeah, I was feeling like war metal shit.
Yeah, me too. I was thinking Blasphemy. I was thinking Inherit.
Especially the third track.
And this is kind of contemporary with that a little bit. You know, it's 1990.
Yeah.
And this is kind of a nothing demo that comes out of nowhere and kind of went nowhere. I've never really heard, you know, I've never really seen anybody post this or talk about it or anything, you know?
Yeah.
I actually heard a lot of Treblinka and early TM ad in here as well.
Oh, yeah, for sure. That makes total sense. That's... kind of where, like, the Belial guitar comes in a little bit.
Sounds occult, like, at points.
It does, yeah.
Like
it sounds very
metal.
Occult. Yeah, it doesn't really, I feel like it doesn't fit in with a lot of the Swedish death metal at all, really. There's not
really
much.
It really doesn't.
Because it's weird, like, with the tremolo riffs, they, like, give off, like, death metal single note, you know, riffing, but also, like, the occult black metal riffing. At the same time, like, it's weird. And I like that, like, I think there's a section in, like, the first song or something where they're doing that exact sort of riffing where they're just, like, going up, like, they'll, let's say, like, 4-3-2-1, like, they're just descending. And that part's fucking sick.
Is that in the first song, you mean?
I think it's in the first song, yeah.
Where it's almost like, it almost sounds like it could be a GBK riff or something at the beginning.
I think it's more towards the middle. It's like, It's weird.
Oh, I thought you were talking about the riff that goes bam down 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 down.
Is that the beginning? No, I with that riff I heard macabre.
Macabre?
Yeah, like you know how they have riffs that are kinda like sing songy and shit?
Yeah, it is sing song.
Oh yeah, I could hear that.
Yeah, I was just hearing like a lot of macabre and I kinda went back into like gloom and stuff. Mm-hmm. Grim Reality, they weren't really doing that there. It was like more on Sinister Slaughter.
Yeah, I don't think they started doing that till Sinister Slaughter.
Yeah, and
like the Vampire of Dusseldorf or whatever.
Yeah, and speaking of them, they're probably my favorite like taking thrash to the next level, because like all that shit's just thrash that they're doing, all the riffing at least.
Yeah, I guess I can't really argue with that.
Because they do like crazy obviously they don't do thrash breakdowns, but
they do chugs.
Yeah, they do chugs and they have like good palm muted, like the fastest fucking picking I've ever heard for that type of shit. It's like
I heard something with like really fast picking today. Do you guys remember a band called Expulsor from Brazil?
No.
Yes, the Unholy One.
Yeah, the Unholy One. The picking is really fucking fast.
Yeah.
For some reason, like I always equated that with Ceremony, that Sinister. Like Psy Project band. Well, I think they both basically have the same album art.
Yeah, it's the same. The Expulsor artwork is a detail of the picture that they use for the ceremony or painting.
Yeah, I think Expulsor did it like a year. They beat him by a year, so they had it before.
Yeah, something like that. I forget who it's by. It's a really old painting, but. Oh, it's been used quite a few times by a few different.
Yeah, bands. It's one of those like, I don't want to call it religious, but it kind of is, right? It's like one of those like heaven, hell, demon.
Cover art is Luca Signorelli's "The Damned Cast into Hell."
Yeah, see, there you go, like hell and demons and stuff.
Painted in the 1400s, possibly 1500s, depending on when he painted it.
It's pretty cool.
It's a 100-year gap, sir.
Well, he lived from the 1400s to the 1500s. I don't know when he painted it in that time.
Yeah, I came across Expulsor today just because I was listening to that band Morbid Insulter from Sweden.
Mm.
If you guys know who that is.
Mm. They're going on quite the dive today.
They're pretty great. Yeah. I had some time to just listen to cool stuff.
Well, you sent just regular Insulter, the sex trash related project. They were great. I was so happy when Nuclear War Now reissued their stuff.
Wait, what did you say about the sex trash? Sorry, I was opening this window.
Insulter, the Brazilian band you sent earlier.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, they're
that big
they're
compilation.
They're connected to sex trash. They share a couple songs and obviously the numbers. So.
I think they're connected to Holocausto, too. I think one of the guys joined Holocausto later.
Yeah.
Yep. I didn't send this... Or what were you going to say?
No, I was just going to say the... one of their demos, I forget which one, has Black Church, and that was also a sex trash song. So they they played around with the...
Wasn't that a panic song, too?
Sorry?
So wasn't that a panic song, too? Panic, the Brazilian band.
I don't remember.
I don't either. I could have sworn
great album, but I don't remember the song titles on there.
I think that's maybe what I was thinking about. And I didn't send this.
The song is just called Rotten Church as well.
Yeah. I was thinking about Rotten Church. My bad.
That's a really good album. That one's
amazing. Yeah, it is. It's really cool. I didn't send you guys this, but I also listened to a band called Holocausto from Colombia. I don't know if you guys have ever heard that.
Mm-hmm.
They have a demo.
I've dug
in
into
92.
The Colombian scene quite a bit. I've heard of them, but I haven't actually heard them yet.
They're really fucking weird. I mean, maybe this has to do with like their later stuff that I didn't listen to, but they classify themselves as technical death metal, or no, sorry, progressive death metal. But the 92 demo that I heard, it's got like a, it looks like Jesus or just some guy with a beard like playing chess. It's like super dissonant chording, and then like it's fucking wacky. You guys need to listen to it. The 92 demo from the Colombian Holocausto.
Okay, I'm down for some Colombian ultra metal.
Yeah, it's ultra metal. It's pretty good.
Oh, you know, that reminds me, that wacky ass solo on the first track in Codex Gigas.
Uh-huh. The one that's like
that reminds me of something. That reminds me of something Reincarnation would do on their first album, you know, 888 Metal. I know it's mm-hmm. not actually called that, but
that's what it translates to.
No, apparently it's only actually self-titled, and 888 Metal was just something they put on there, and everyone started calling it that.
I wonder what that even means, 888 Metal.
I have no clue.
It's like 666 wasn't good enough, but 777, that's like heaven, so you get 888.
If you're 555, then I'm 888.
Yeah, there you go.
Please no.
Mom, we all love Slipknot here.
I'm dying to feel this.
Can you feel this?
Pick up the bass.
Yo, Slipknot and Korn, they got some brutal death metal riffs.
Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum.
Dig it.
I always love the bass sound on Dead Bodies Everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
That was my
floppy Korn bass sound.
Not into death metal yet phase.
Same here.
Yeah, I was listening to Korn during the same phase, not into death metal yet.
Yeah, and then Jonathan Davis is, like, wearing Cannibal Corpse shirts while he's playing live.
Awesome.
He knew.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like Noah was saying. It's like, obviously, these guys were all listening to death metal. What else would they be listening to?
Yeah.
I don't think I've mentioned on the show that I'm a huge System of a Down fan.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I can never get into them, but I did really get into Korn. And,
yeah, System was, like, one of my first favorite bands. Probably like middle school.
Yeah, for me it was mostly Korn and Rage Against the Machine. Those were the I guess Rage doesn't really count as new metal, I guess, but
nah, they're like something else. Yeah, they're
adjacent.
Like
alt, I think they're like alt metal.
They don't really have a genre. I mean, alt something, it would make sense to classify them under that.
Yeah.
But
I've heard them called like rap metal before. During that time. I don't know how I feel about that.
Sure. But I don't think they're metal at all. I think just call them rap rock.
Yeah.
Because they're not even as heavy as
whatever they are. I like it a lot. Still do like it a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've kind of fallen away from Rage Against the Machine. I did like them.
Fallen away from me?
I can't. Yeah. and kind of same with Smashing Pumpkins a bit.
Never got into them really. I heard they're some riff gods though.
They have
still
my
favorite band.
I guess their lesser known stuff, or at least that album with the it's got like a lady and a, like on a star on it.
Yeah,
that's like the Melancholy. Good one or something. Yep.
Oh. No, they're still my favorite band. They always have been since I first heard them, and that hasn't changed. I have a ton of their stuff.
Despite all Fred's rage, he's still just a rat in a cage.
If you want to hear a really cool song from them, that's it feels really inspired by The Cure. Check out Dead Forever. It's actually from their one of their demos. And it's a really cool song. I like that one a lot. But like
Forever?
I'm Jennifer Ever.
Oh.
But okay. Yeah, my favorite album from them is actually Machina, the one from 2000 that no one likes.
Like Ex Machina?
It's Machina, the Machines of God.
Yeah, not that weird.
I like that movie.
Yeah.
That chick was pretty hot.
I'll check it out for, that chick was a robot.
That chick? Yeah, that's the gist of the movie. That chick was a robot, dude.
more than the gist of the whole fucking thing.
Mm-hmm. Chick's a robot, dude. dude.
Yep.
But anyways. The dude. Glad to know the dude's still out there. You have to use so many cuss words. Okay. Had either of you guys heard this album before? Or this demo?
No, I hadn't heard it.
Yeah, help him write it.
No. No way. You do not know Codex.
I played bass on it.
Oh, man.
That was the female vocals.
The female vocals? You were the female vocals? Kind of like Fenris in Goat Lore doing the female vocals?
Yeah, they just pitched me.
That was so weird. It's so jarring.
But yeah, never heard it.
Had you ever heard anybody talk about it, Fred, since you've kind of an expert on this stuff?
I'd heard the name, just never got around to checking it out.
Yeah, the name has to do with, like, the Devil's Bible or something.
Yeah. But I just love that
death
they,
metal band.
Right out of the gates, they're bizarre with those female vocals right out of the gate. I had to do a double take and listen to it like 2 or 3 times. I'm like, was that actually in there? They're really buried under the guitars and the vocals, but they're whatever the vocalist is doing, the girl that's singing on it, I think I saw in the liner notes, her name is Maria. She's doing it too, but you have to really listen for it. But I kind of heard it right off the bat. I'm like, what the fuck was that?
Yeah, I didn't catch it.
Yeah, I didn't catch it either.
Well, I think we're playing that one, right? So we'll
keep an ear out for it. There.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Man.
Female vocals.
Not only the female vocals, but did you guys also get monkey vibes?
Monkey? What do you mean monkey?
There was like one vocal. Monkey. There was like one vocal in there that was like.
there's
but it went like twice. It was like 3 times towards the end of the first song.
No, I remember a vocal like that. Maybe it was the first song where it does it really loud and obnoxious, like a high pitched monkey screech.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I caught one of them. I caught the really loud one. You know how you were just talking about Fenris when he's doing the female vocals? I think he mentions that in his like those little commentaries that he does.
Yeah.
Do you guys remember he mentions Family Guy in one of those commentaries?
I never listened to commentaries.
He's talking about like something that made him like cringe in the album. He goes, "Oh, this part." He goes, "I feel like Peter Griffin when
oh, yeah.
he hurts his knee." I thought that was funny.
That was weird, though, reissuing the Dark Throne albums with a second disc that has commentary over it. That's
funny.
It's funny, but it's bizarre.
It's content.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it works on YouTube as well.
Yeah, it's like the bonus
Radio
features.
Fenris!
Belt bucket?
He's a belt bucket. Taking care of business. Rock and roll gas station and all that. Yeah, anyways, that first riff and the first song, it really did remind me of like GBK or like Cauldron Black Ram too.
Yeah, I was hearing that too. Yeah, just that pirate kind of
pirate
swag.
Swag.
It's very bouncy, isn't it?
But like when I heard it initially, like I mentioned before, it was like macabre to me. Where they kind of like have the vocals and the riffs like going at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah, because even they bring it back towards like the end. I think it's like one of the last riffs to end the song, and they're kind of doing that shit too.
Yeah, the third track, the one that was a bit more, I guess, war metal styled.
Yeah.
It made me think of another Swedish band that came like a year or two after called Lucifer. They didn't really fit in very well with the rest of the Swedish bands I found, and it was a bit more chaotic and aggressive in that sense. So it reminded me a lot of that Lucifer stuff,
Yeah, this is
they had an EP called The Dark Christ. That was really cool.
Yeah, because this is straight up fucking chaotic as fuck.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. There's like things you can pick out from this. Like in that first song, there's a part where it stops and it does this like Slayer buildup thing.
Yeah. I like their. Go ahead.
I feel like a Swedish death metal band just like wouldn't overtly do that. While this band, I don't know. Does this sound? Would you call this like black death? Is this kind of a mix of both?
I think so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I could see it.
But like
if it was just the first track, maybe I'd stick closer to death. But
yeah,
with everything going on throughout the whole demo, I'm fine with calling it Black Death. I think that's got a bit of everything in it.
Yeah. All right, what were you gonna say, Paul?
Oh, they do this like really sick ass like chug riff. It's like chug 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 chug.
In the first song, right?
Yeah, and it's like in between the solos.
Yeah. Where the guitar's going.
Dude, that sounds like when screwing around. That sounds like when Pac-Man's chasing the ghost, dude.
Yeah, that chug is really weird. I feel like most death metal bands wouldn't do that either.
No, it was like an interesting one.
Especially in 90.
Yeah.
Like, isn't this weird for 1990? It's so fucking bizarre.
Yeah, it's really early for what it is. Like, it's... along with Tiamat and like Grotesque, I can't think of a lot of other bands in Sweden that were doing something like this.
Maybe Morbid.
And Morbid was a bit more
to a certain degree.
Maybe. They were a bit thrashier, like black thrash, like, sort of.
Yeah, they're like evil thrash.
But yeah, like these guys had like fucking melody in there too, towards like the end of that first track where
reminded me of
Necrobiosis type shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's like the only moment on this where there's like this emotional melody kind of thing, right?
Yeah, and like their whole like structures of the song, or at least like lack of narrative of it, was like starting and like doing these stop-start kind of riffs. Like how you said, like that Slayer thing, like they just like stop right before, go right into that riff. And I feel like they're doing that a lot, especially in that fucking in the second song. Right? Yeah, it's like doesn't even go through like a full like measure of music, and then it like cuts out.
I think they do like three counts each. They don't do a full four count.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like an intro with the guy girl vocal combo, which is it's actually pretty cool sounding.
Yeah.
And then it goes into a riff. A blasting riff for like, I don't know, maybe 4 seconds. Yeah. goes back into this clean that acoustic guitar kind of interlude thing, and then you get another blasting riff for about 2 seconds.
I thought that like that faked me out. I thought I was like, oh okay, the third song's coming up. Like that was weird. But then it was like,
and then it goes back.
Yeah,
and then it does a riff again, and then it goes back into the interlude.
Yeah,
it's very strange. I wonder why that is. Did they rehearse those as songs, or did they just rehearse those as riffs? And
yeah, it sounds like they put them in. Sounds like they put the tape like in a blender and kind of just stitched it back together.
Yeah. Kind of like
whose bright idea was this?
Yeah, kind of like the My Dying Bride at the end of the album. They have something like that.
Yeah,
but this is just way more extreme in the sense of like how fucking goofy it is.
Dude, and they do like a really interesting thing that I always love with like blast beats. Instead of doing like double kicks over the blast beat, like they'll do a stomp over it. So they'll be blasting and they'll just have like the 8th note of like a, like bringing, building that intensity and shit.
Yeah, so let's go pop, 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 pop.
Yeah, that's so fucking sick.
While the other thing is, yeah, those are cool.
Yeah, I don't hear too many bands doing that. They'll either like have the kicks exactly the same as the snare, or they'll have it faster, you know, but no one just does a single kick. It's just so much more primitive and aggressive, and gets that point across, I feel like, the best, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what Noah was talking about when they did the Deteriorat review. He was talking about like comparing new death metal bands to old death metal bands. A big difference is there's a lot more blast beats in the old stuff.
Yeah.
And a lot more variation in the types of blast beats and how you do them.
Yeah, definitely. Because, like, yeah, you sure, know. You can get all technical, like, technical death metal where they'll do, you know, a bunch of different blasting on it, but it just doesn't feel... It feels more like an exercise than, like, actual music, you know?
Yeah, yeah, I know exactly what you mean. I feel the same way about certain riffs when it comes to, like, technical death metal bands. A lot of them don't feel like riffs. A lot of them feel like, yeah, like what you said, exercises.
Yeah, just like read it out of the practice book and just made it into a riff.
Yeah, and I guess the same could be said about drum beats too.
Yeah.
I think, you know, I never exactly understood what it was about modern metal that I don't really care for much. I think maybe something like that is kind of inching towards, you know, why. There's like a lack of experimentation and kind of a lack of passion, maybe.
Yeah, and the experimentation is like more like formulaic, and kind of there's like a template, like how we always mention the tech riff
or the prog riff. Is that those bands back in the 90s were striving to move forwards, and that's how they all started moving away from death metal at some point, right? Whereas the bands today are looking to move backwards and go back to what those bands were doing originally. There's not it's not really an atmosphere of experimentation so much as an atmosphere of worship.
Yeah, and even like the bands, like the Finnish bands, for example, like they straight up said they're bored with death metal, and it seems like how you said, like people are just worshiping death metal now and not really coming up with something of their own.
Well, it's not just that. It's not just the bands trying to be old school. It's also the bands that want to be like your stereotypical tech death band. Because all those really aren't moving forward. They all seem to be stuck in this sphere that kind of just goes in a circle and really doesn't add anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Let me be the first drummer to have 400 BPM blast beats.
You know? Yeah, like with this, it's so much different. Like, there's so much experimentation with this, especially being, you know, as early as it is. Even if this was from 95, I would be impressed, but the fact that it's from 90 is, it's pretty impressive.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I don't really think there's anything bad on this demo. I think every part is pretty important to it.
Yeah, and I couldn't help but, like, think of the comparison of, like, the, you know, the Necrovores and stuff like that, just with the chaos, but it seemed like a lot more refined here.
Yeah, yeah, it's like it's definitely more refined. It's more subdued.
It's like a fusion rather than like it's like so chaotic, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
it's
with the comparison
filtered through the a cleaner Swedish death metal sound.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And like you were saying, Fred, the comparison to Grotesque, it makes sense, cuz Grotesque is like, yeah, one of the earliest bands to kind of merge sounds, even before maybe not merge sounds, but I guess it is merging sounds, but not in a way that's conscious. They're doing it unconsciously, because like death metal really isn't even fully fledged at that point. I mean, they were doing Grotesque in like 88, 89, 90. Yeah. So at that point, you know, there's not much to there's not much to take from. They're kind of just coming up with heavy shit on their own, and it happens to be Black Death, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and
yeah, I mean, they still had bands like Obscurity that were banging around this sort of thing in like 86, even Grave, what they were called, Corpse back then, I think. Like, they've been that sound was there, but infusing it with a bit more death or black metal feel into it, I think that's where Grotesque Release stepped in, along with Treblinka, and I think that's where they must have taken the most cues from their surrounding scene anyways.
Yeah, I mean, Grotesque feels a lot more refined than something like Obscurity, like you said.
Yeah. Yeah, I know for sure.
And they got the black metal whispers on here too.
Yeah, yeah, there's whispers on here. It's really cool. I really like the whispers. I don't know that I've ever heard the Corpse material. Like, that pre-Grave, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy. How young they were when they were doing that? Because I thought they were pretty fucking young when they were in Grave already.
I know they. I forget what the bands were called here. Here, I'll pull them up. But I know they've been around in some way, shape, or form since like 84. And I don't know whether they recorded anything or necessarily released anything under those older monikers. But I know they started as Corpse in like 86 and only lasted a couple years under that name before changing to Grave. Here, so here we go. So Grave was called Rising Power in 84, 85. Destroyer in 85, Anguish from 85 to 86, and then Corpse from 86 to 88, and then changing to Grave. So
Oh,
they've
okay.
been around for a long ass time.
Yeah, that's insane.
But the
Yeah,
I know I think Century Media reissued all the Grave demos as along with the Corpse demos, so it's out there.
Coolaroonis.
Yeah, surprisingly, no thrash too much on here. Or
There's a little bit.
not that
Not
much thrash.
much. Not much. It's mostly
No.
like
Thank God.
chugging it. Yeah,
Yeah,
it's mostly like Black Death, war metal,
it's like the
and like
weird like single note tremolo death metal riffs.
yeah, and like chugging and I mean, there's some weird stuff that goes on in the third track too, like
I
that
think,
first that intro riff, that bouncy one, that
dude, and
kind of.
even the ending of the first song where it's like there's the guitars bouncing in between the channels, like left and right, like you hear like one riff on the side and then they'll jump to the other side, just switching off, riffs and shit.
Yeah.
That part's sick, but you were saying in the third song?
Yeah, the third song has like some riffs that sound like they could be from the first Tankard album or something. So there's a little bit of thrash here. And also in the last track, yeah, that bouncy riff. That one sounds a lot like Piranha from Exodus. It's just slowed down and more chunky. And then in that last one, they also have like one of those spider type of death metal riffs, kind of like Dismember at the end of Soon to Be Dead. You know what I'm talking about?
Spider.
Yeah. Well, it makes I call it a spider riff because that's what your hand is kind of doing.
Okay.
Like it looks like a spider walking.
Thought you were talking about the School of Rock guy.
Ding. Oh, hey,
Well, what did you guys
Spider.
think of that second track?
The one with the intro and the two riffs?
Pax Vobiscum.
It
I
was.
like
The
it.
almost interlude-ish kind of track.
I like it.
Yeah.
It's weird. Like we said, it sounds like you could have just kind of cut and paste the tape together and like had two riffs randomly there. I don't exactly know why they're there.
Yeah, I wonder if they're like taken from like if it's original material for that second song or if it's like actual bits and pieces from the other songs.
You know what it made me think of? It made me think of some of the weirder Black Legion stuff, like Movat. Yeah, exactly. The chanting and the acoustic guitar, just like weird shit like that.
You know how like later in that song, that Movat song, they go, ah, there's some of that
Yep.
going on. I remember seeing a Breaking Bad clip, like edit, where it was Junior and Walt in their new cars, and you know how it's like going showing them back and forth in the camera,
Yeah.
but it's the Movat song. Whoever did that, that's pretty good. I think it might have been the Spare Thy Sharpest Blades guy.
Okay. Yeah, that.
Yeah, that was funny.
Yeah.
Oh, Black
I
Legion.
guess I guess in terms of like it is a pretty weird death metal demo. I mean, I wouldn't exactly know what else to compare it to like fully as a demo or as an album at all, really. It's too weird, but it's heavy. I guess something you maybe could compare it to would be like Dismal Insanity. I don't know if you guys have ever heard that band.
No.
They're
What is
from
that?
Belarus. just another weird death metal demo. A band called Decay from Slovakia. Kind of reminded me of that. One, you know, Paul, I know. Euthanasia. Yeah. That mellow dying thing. It's kind of in the sense of that, where it's totally just off the walls experimental. Not off the walls wild, but in terms of experimenting and it working really well. And also without it being gimmicky. I feel like it's really hard for bands to be experimental, especially back in the 90s too, without being gimmicky. I feel like you remember, Paul, when you were showing me a bunch of those like progressive death metal bands from Slovakia?
I think so,
and,
yeah.
And like Czech and Poland and stuff. Mm-hmm. I feel like a lot of those really rely on...
like Hieronymus Bosch and shit?
No, not really like them. I don't even remember the names of some of these bands you were showing me. A lot of them were like, they really rely on acoustic guitars and piano.
Oh yeah, parts. Some like, weird instrumentation that
right
they stitched
in the middle,
together.
Stitched together. I never understood how bands did that.
It's just like layers. Just studio magic, basically.
Yeah, it is studio magic. I never really liked that because it's not
real.
It's not natural.
Yeah,
you're not doing that in the fucking practice studio. You're not stopping, and then there's a keyboard part for like 30 seconds, and then there's an acoustic guitar part.
Yeah,
there's a fucking saxophone.
It sticks out like a sore thumb.
It does, it does. I don't really care for that kind of shit. I mean, the only time I would really, maybe one of the only times I would ever be like okay with it is Panthymonium.
Yeah.
Just because I know that's not natural.
It's good.
I know they're not natural, but I feel like it works. It really works there with like the later Panthymonium stuff, like the last two albums or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of Slovakian bands, have you guys heard Amorbital?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
RFI just did a little demo on it.
Awesome.
I haven't seen that, or I haven't listened to that episode yet.
It's good.
Are you talking about the Crystal Rhapsody one?
Yeah.
Yeah, and the album NVIDIA.
Yeah, the NVIDIA album's good.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, I was on a little kick of like Slovakian death metal for something we were writing a little while ago. Like Apoplexy I was really into as well.
Oh, is that why you sent over Sanatorium?
Sanatorium? When did I send over Sanatorium?
I feel like it was the other sent it over to me. Arrival of the Forgotten Ones?
Honestly, I don't even... Wait, who the fuck is Sanatorium?
It's a Slovakian death metal. I guess they're more brutal, but...
Just leave me alone.
Maybe it wasn't you that sent it over. I don't know.
No,
that was an album
I don't think
known
so.
for quite a while.
It was not him.
And I hadn't thought about it for ages. And now I guess someone else sent it to me. Well,
yeah,
check it out.
Yeah,
Sanatorium, Arrival of the Forgotten Ones.
Yeah, I know you like
Slovakian
that...
Slovakian death metal from like 99.
Oh, okay.
I know you like that first Apoplexy album, Tears of the Unborn, but have you heard Monarchy of the Damned?
Probably, but I don't really remember it.
Dude, that one's fucking great. I think I like this one better. It's from 99.
Monarchy of the Damned. You know what? No, I don't think I have heard it.
Filthy ass fucking metal death.
I'll have to check that out. Apple.
I don't think I've heard that one either, actually. I know Tears, but I don't know Monarchy.
The Monarch! Oh, the
Venture
Brothers movie wasn't that great.
Oh, my dad's stanza.
I think what really surprised me about Codex Gigas, though, is given how weird and, I guess, forward-thinking it was for the time, that it hasn't been reissued in any way, shape, or form.
Like, I don't think anybody knows somebody knows who this is. It's on Metal Archives.
Someone knows the members somewhere. Like, they must be around.
Yeah, like it really is pretty good, right? I mean, it's not. It feels like it shouldn't have been totally forgotten.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, I think it's pretty good. Oh, Fun Cunt maybe is another weird one, but that's way that's something else.
Yeah.
That's definitely something else.
That like weird jazz part with the fucking saxophone. And it's like broken up by them all yelling. I feel like that one might be influenced by like fucking atheists too. Just weird heck thrash.
Bizarrely,
yeah. Maybe we should listen to that song.
Let's do it. Let's do it, boo boo.
Want to intro
listen
it?
For the female vocals.
Okay, listening for the female vocals. Okay, this is Severed Myom. Ready?
Yep.
Ah!
shit! Goodness! Do my song!
Kind of remind me of the Grona Bard yelps too.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was fucking awesome.
Yeah, that went everywhere.
It sucked.
Ah, man, are you kidding? That was absurdly heavy.
You're wrong.
Yeah, I like it.
The fucking chugs, the fucking Paul called them monkey vocals.
Yeah. Yeah, they're Fred just sprinkled in.
I just love how disjointed the whole song is. It just jumps from one idea to another, and it pulls it off so well.
Evil fucking chug riff, and then it like does a, it goes in between the doom sort of drumming, and then goes into like slow ass, kind of reminds me of Cauldron Black Ram, like slow thrash D beat drumming, you know?
That song, it feels like Cauldron Black Ram and GBK in the sense that it moves around a lot, and also it's mocking you with its riffs and its vocals. This whole thing is
just swagged out.
The album cover, the demo cover, this guy Bob.
Yeah,
everything about this is just, it's mocking you.
Yeah, Bob is a psychopath.
They're having fun at your expense.
Well, I'm having fun too. So how about that?
Yeah, how about that, Bob? Where are you, Bob? Come get me, dude.
Yeah, I was going to say, someone Bob's just has... Like
the,
his...
Bob's the burn victim from fucking Disneyland.
It
all makes sense now.
Yeah.
I was saying, someone just has this cassette lying around somewhere.
Daniel Ekeroth might have a copy of this. Dude,
about it.
Yeah, do you have that book handy?
It'll take me a few seconds to get it, yeah.
Yeah, look this up. See if there's... you know how there's like liner notes in the back about like every Swedish death metal band that ever existed?
Well, probably not this one, but we'll see.
Well, let's see. Let's see.
BRB.
You don't know nothing about that book, do you?
I know about it, but I don't have it.
Oh, it's pretty cool. There's like, it's mostly just a lot of stories from members of the Swedish death metal scene.
Yeah.
Just like telling their side, pretty much. It's not really about any, it's not like a informative thing. It's informative in the sense that you get kind of stories.
I was looking at the CD compilation that came with the book. It doesn't look like Codex Gigas showed up on there.
No, I wouldn't imagine it would. No, but there's like an index in the back that has just about every Swedish death metal band like ever. And he has a little just a little blurb about each of them.
It does have Macrodex go. That's a cool band.
Macrodex, dude, I forgot about Macrodex. Man, I
Back
remember
looking it up.
I remember there was a story. I think it was the guys from Unleashed. They were talking about Fenriz and Darkthrone when they went down to Sweden to record Soulside Journey.
Yeah.
And they were saying that I believe it was Johnny from Unleashed. He said the Swedes, or I don't know who it was, but he said the Norwegians were such nerds. He goes, they just acted like a bunch of dorks. And he goes, this guy Fenriz, he shows up in a cowboy hat and he's telling everybody to call him Hank Amarillo. You've heard that name, right? Hank Amarillo.
Yeah, the copy I have of Soulside Journey calls him that.
Yeah, apparently that was his like alter ego when he put on the cowboy hat.
They changed that in later issues. I have the reissue from like 2012, one or something, and on that one they changed it to Fenriz, but the
So
earlier pressings it's Hank.
cool. So with fucking Macrodex, is like all their stuff good? Because I've heard I'm looking for the fucking demo that I've heard from Macrodex. It might have been a fucking like a comp or something, because I can't find the
Yeah,
artwork.
I have the
Is
Macrodex of
there
War
a
compilation.
comp?
Yeah, it's listed under the name Crypt of Kerberos, but it's got the Macrodex stuff on there.
Wait, are these the guys from Crypt of Kerberos?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
They Macrodex basically became Crypt of Kerberos. Well, not became, but it's parallel band.
Do you know a Death Doom band called September that's connected to Macrodex?
Don't think
Because this
so.
looks cool. This looks cool, and I like the name. I
Well,
kind of. I hope I don't forget. I want to look some of this stuff up.
I was gonna say, with all the anticipation, of course there's not anything, but
There's nothing, huh?
yeah, but I'll read a Crypt of Kerberos little blurb that
Okay,
they
I like
said.
them.
It said, "The sick bastard also made music for a porn film."
Oh, there you go.
Well, he is a sick bastard.
Oh,
Fucking sicko.
I'm mistaken though. The compilation I have is just Crypto Kerberos demos. It doesn't go about far back as Macrodex stuff.
Macrodex? Ah, bollocks.
Yeah,
Wait, how
probably
old is
true on
fucking
you.
Macrodex? Okay, it's 1989. Yeah, man,
Yeah, I
I don't
probably
want to
heard the demos
forget.
on YouTube, but I just assumed they were on that compilation, but they're not.
Yeah, I don't want to forget this. I'd like to check out some Macrodex again. I haven't listened to these guys in many years.
Yeah,
And
they're
Crypt of
awesome.
Kerberos, man. I remember that all their shit was really good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And these guys are connected to Chronic Decay and House of Usher too, which was really good. I don't know if you guys know House of Usher.
I remember
Yeah.
them.
Yeah, they had some weird song titles. I remember they had a song title called like, oh no, it's a demo. It's called When Being Fucked With.
Yeah.
It's like a
And there was
dying
something.
fetus, one wrong one to fuck with.
Then they have another demo called When no, that's the same one. And it has a song on there called Dead Fish.
Ooh.
On the very verge. I gotta listen to this stuff again too. Kind of sticking with Sweden a little bit.
I mean, they had a ton of shit to listen to.
Yeah, there's a
That's
whole
true,
book.
that's true. Yeah, read that book.
I read it in a book.
Bug.
ASMR.
Yeah, what did I write here? I wrote Exodus Piranha, The Rot. Yeah, that song that did remind me of that. And I wrote that too, that one riff. Down, 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 do, 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 do.
Yeah.
I wrote Lord of the Rings, Goblin Town.
Yeah, it does sound kind of like.
Down, down to Goblin Town.
Sounds like it would be like a dungeon synth like passage or something.
Yeah, it's really weird. I didn't write too much here. I guess, yeah, blasphemy, beher it. Maybe that's a point that could be brought up. This comes out before Belial, and they're doing kind of the Belial riff. You know who else kind of does that a little bit? Fred was we were just talking about them. Grotesque does that riff a lot too. The single note, that kind of those crazy ones. I'm trying to think of what, because this comes out 88. When do they start doing that type of riff? These guys are probably closer, because the incantation. Yeah, Blood Runs from the Altar, that comes out in 90. So let's just say this has those kinds of riffs, and that's this Grotesque is 1990, and also Codex Gigas is 1990, but it's 1 year before Belial has anything. So there you go. It's pretty early. It's pretty innovative. It's almost like it kind of reminds me of like. Even some of the bands we were talking about on the horror episode, like Incubus or like Totem, where it's I don't know, experimenting with like the heaviest riffs ever.
Yeah,
Just being cool. It's just
definitely.
cool.
Yeah, definitely had heavy fucking chugs. It was like too heavy for 1990, this shit.
It's way too heavy.
That and
And
then.
if you look at that album, the demo cover enough, it's starts to get a little spooky.
Sort
I'm gonna
of
see that in my
random
dreams.
fun fact about Grotesque, the first track on the Incantation EP, the lyrics part of them are ripped right out of a an Elric of Melniboné book. The
I
part that
don't know who
goes
that is. I'm a dumb dumb who doesn't read
bone,
anything.
blood, flesh and sinew, spell and spirit bind anew. It's from an author called Michael Moorcock. And he
I've heard of
said,
him, I think.
The Sir Thongol guy?
yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
And
that's
so
why it sounds
the
familiar.
guy on the Sir Thungol covers is Elric of Melniboné, and I'm pretty sure that those lines come from the first or second book in that series. But there
If
you
you
go.
look up Grotesque on Metal Archives, who's the guy with the cool haircut?
That would be me.
You see what I'm talking about, Paul? Do you know which guy I'm talking about?
No, I'm looking now.
I'd
The
have
guy
to
in the
get
middle.
my copy to see if they name who is which.
Do you see the
'Cause I'm pretty
haircut?
Yeah. It's
pretty sure
Who
the guy
is
at the front
that?
is
It's like a
pretty sure the guy at the
Culvus.
front is Goat Spell.
Oh, that is. That's the guy from At the Gates.
It's like a
At
fucking
the front,
cul-de-sac
yeah.
with the mohawk.
He looks like who?
No, it looks like a cul-de-sac like haircut, but with the fucking mohawk in there.
Yeah, it's a strange do. Kind of reminds me of like the fucking the way he looks like hardcore punk or something, like the Authorize album or band picture. Remember those guys?
Oh yeah, authorize.
Yeah, look that up, Paul. Look up their band picture. 'Cause they just look like punks, but they made some pretty fucking heavy death metal. If you remember that album they did. This guy has straight up the same haircut as Vivian from The Young Ones. It looked like an airplane. Yeah, Paul, you remember this album, The Source of Dominion? The one with the well on it?
me see.
They only had the one.
No, I don't think I've ever heard this.
Check it out. It's heavy.
91.
I'm looking at this record label that they were on too. Not a whole lot of things come out of there. A band called Nomid? Thrash band?
Oh, is that the
That
French
says.
band?
Yuck.
Yes, it is. Are they any good?
Yeah,
I've
they were
never heard of them
cool.
before. Really?
They were cool.
The first album or The Vision of God or. Yeah, there's only two albums.
I don't remember what I heard from them, but I remember
First
liking what
album's
I
called
heard.
Like.
I think there was a compilation of their
Like.
demos.
Like what?
Yeah, there's a compilation of their demos on Almendralamel Records. That's what That's what I've heard. That stuff is
fuck cool. Yeah.
Sound like, sorry. Sound like Peggy a little bit.
Oh yeah. Paddling Peggy Hill.
Your grandma loves you.
All right, you guys want to say any last words about this? Get get ding going.
I heard him barking earlier. Let's let Fred go first. What do you think, Frederick?
That's what I think. Bark, bark, bark.
Bark, bark, bark.
What a weird fucking demo. Like, I loved it. Yeah, the idea, they have so many ideas and they didn't know how to put them together, but somehow it worked. I don't know why. Maybe it's because I like ridiculous shit, but the bouncing riffs, it going from side to side, that bizarre interlude track, and then randomly pulling to like bestial style stuff. It's a lot of fun. It doesn't fit with the Swedish scene or anything really. It's kind of just out of left field, but my god, is it fun, and is it ahead of its time. Like, it's a wild listen. I love it. I'm glad you brought this one up for today, because I probably wouldn't have gone out and way listened to it. I figured, you know what, Swedish death metal from 1990, I probably know what that sounds like. Exactly. I definitely did not know how that was supposed to sound like.
Exactly. Yeah, most people would be like, forget about it.
Yeah, I'd be like, oh, it probably sounds like Entombed. Cool. Bye.
Yeah. That's, oh, a Swedish death metal demo. Okay, God, what do we got? God Macabre. Okay, blah, blah, blah. We already know what Swedish death metal sounds like. Not this one. I think there's one moment on here where you get like a Swedish kind of D-beat stuff. But you get the really fuzzy bass, and it almost reminds me of Profanatica or something.
The whole thing, you know, it did have Swedish death metal vibes throughout a chunk of it, but it felt like Treblinka with ADHD and just not knowing what to do next.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if they didn't know what to do, or they kind of just
had too many ideas on what to do.
Yeah, they had a lot of ideas, and they just shoved them into a demo and called it Bob's Angels, and there it is. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I love this thing.
Just shoved.
I don't come back to it very often. Like, well,
I guess that's all our ideas. We're gonna split up now.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
One more demo, and they're like, "Yeah, this didn't work out. All right, we're done."
Yeah, let's change our band name.
Fuck, make your mark. Like Maimed or something. Do a demo. Do something cool, and maybe 30 years later somebody will find it on YouTube, and then we'll just kind of talk about it while I'm like sitting here, a cup of water. I have my bed like hunched up a little bit. What do you call these things? Tempur-Pedic, you know.
That's right.
Yeah, remember my neighbor said that.
Yeah.
That's right.
What is wrong with your neighbor?
I don't. Why did he say that to us?
I had no idea.
He said something to us, and I'm like, "Yup." He goes, "That's right." It wasn't even my neighbor. It was the neighbor's boyfriend. That guy didn't even live there.
That's right.
But I remember I was taking out the trash, you know, on trash night, and I was just in my shorts, no shirt, taking out the trash, and at the exact same time I came out the gate with the trash can, this guy's coming out the gate with the trash can, shorts, no shirt. And I'm like, hey, we're doing the same thing. He goes, oh yeah.
What the hell?
Paul, I told you about my new neighbors, right? Like what that guy used to do like a year ago when they first moved in. He was like up at 2 a.m.
No, I don't remember.
No? Yeah, he would get up at 2 a.m, go in his backyard and start working and just like be moving stuff, and he'd be very he would try to be very quiet about it. like moving stuff, but he's back there like a fucking ghoul.
Dude, that probably takes like twice as much like fucking work and effort to try to be quiet doing shit.
Yeah.
And it doesn't really work.
It's like dropping a spoon in the middle of the night.
We got security cameras, and my dad, I guess he like looked at the security camera and he saw a guy in a hoodie, and he opens the window and goes, "Hey, who the fuck's out there?" And the guy goes, "Dave, it's me, whatever his name is." He goes, "Oh, all right." Paul, you remember my other neighbor, that girl who was always like yelling at her mom?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would record it and like send it to the group chat. Fuck you, mom.
Yeah,
that chick was wacky.
Got angsty in there.
Yes, sir.
But yeah, this fucking album or demo is weird as fuck. The solos, the vocals, the riffs. The
solos go on for too long.
God, the solos are fucking mental.
Over different sections of the songs, like they cut out, like you think they're gonna end, and they just like slow down too, or they just go hyperspeed with it, and the monkey vocals, fucking the weird second song. It's just like, I don't know. It's
extremely
just
occult and unnerving.
Yeah.
And fucking heavy.
Yeah, it's just something you can only do on demos, you know? And I can't imagine them getting away with this or even wanting to do something like this again, because their Livid demo, which came out 2 years later, didn't sound much like this at all. It sounded a little bit more refined and it's more, you know, down the middle black death metal, you know? It didn't have any of the crazy shit.
I feel like that would have more grind to it just based on the name.
Yeah.
It's still pretty occult sounding.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like the black kind of death metal, but doesn't have any of the wackiness to it, at least from what I heard.
Yeah, this one sounds death metal, but it feels black metal, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's satanic death metal.
Kind of like the Amon album we spoke about a few weeks ago.
Yeah, it sounds like death metal, but it feels like black metal.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right.
Yeah, and it's right. Yeah, it's very in your face. It's a very big fuck you, ha ha, look what we're doing. Uh-huh. Like that? You like that, buddy?
You thought this was Swedish? Fucking idiot.
Yeah. Oh, you thought this was gonna be a typical Swedish death metal demo? Fuck you, buddy.
Well, anyway, yeah, go listen to this. This is great.
Yeah, it's not a Sunlight Studios album.
Nope.
Tommy Scott. This ain't no Tommy Skogsberg. Well, all right. We good?
Yep.
Bye. Codex bye, Gigas bye, bye.
Signing off.
That's right.